It was a Hollywood story without a Hollywood ending.
Nobody thought to go to the police. Nobody thought to warn Bob Samuels.
Very decomposed. It was a very gruesome scene.
A lust for the good life that reached lethal proportions.
He's saying that you're going to inherit $500,000.
She threw money around like it was growing on trees.
It was always really short, or really low cut.
She hired a male stripper for her daughter's 16th birthday party.
It was all lies. She told all lies.
I have no idea who was doing this. I could not hurt a fly.
Both these murders were committed for the sole sake of money.
An unforgettable villain.
We believe that you had something to do with his death.
Oh, my God.
And a plot so outrageous, you won't believe it's a work of nonfiction. Hollywood in the 1980s was anything goes.
There was a lot of parties, a lot of drinking, a lot of drugs. There was a lot of excess.
But the film industry was also filled with people who cared more about the craft of movie making than the glitter of Hollywood. People like Bob Samuels. In the late 80s, the 40-year-old was at the top of the Hollywood A-list as a successful assistant cameraman.
Bob worked on Beverly Hills Cop 2, Lethal Weapon 2.
Bob, when he got into the film industry, he worked on a lot of motion pictures. The first picture that he worked on was Color Purple.
Bob personified the hard-working, dedicated, conscientious. He spent, sometimes 80 hours work weeks during productions, did a lot of traveling.
But just as his career was reaching its pinnacle, Bob was attacked in his home. His estranged wife, Mary Ellen, finds his body and calls the LAPD.
I was one of the first to be on the crime scene of the Robert Samuels murder. The crime scene is in a upper middle class area of the San Fernando Valley. Very quiet, very nice.
Officers find Mary Ellen and her 17-year-old daughter, Nicole, waiting for them.
Mary Ellen Samuels was hysterical. She was clinging to her dead husband's body.
Mary Ellen explains that though she and Bob were separated, it wasn't unusual for her and Nicole to drop in for a visit.
They had seen that Bob's car was in the driveway. Mary Ellen knocked on the door. There was no answer. She pounded on the door. Again, no answer. And then she tried the door. It was unlocked.
Moments later, she saw his body in the hallway.
He had been struck in the back of the head with a long object, and then a pillow was apparently placed on the back of his head, and he was shot in the back of the head with a shotgun.
Police find no sign of forced entry, and but for some broken china, there's no indication of a botched burglary.
There wasn't really very much disturbed and no evidence of ransacking.
Bob Samuels' wallet was found with all of his credit cards, with money in it. There did not appear to be anything whatsoever taken.
Bob Samuels was hit on the back of the head with the barrel of a shotgun. Ed appeared to be a hitman with some strength.
An orchestrated hit means cops are naturally going to look at the estranged wife. But Mary Ellen would have needed the upper body strength of an Olympic shot putter to have pulled this murder off. As part of standard police procedure, cops questioned Bob's friends and relatives.
It was really a shock. It's like one minute you have a brother and the next minute you don't.
By all accounts, Bob was your salt of the earth kind of guy. Thoughtful, hardworking, and generous.
I was fortunate enough when Bob was filming Beverly Hills Cop 2, he got me on as an extra, as a police officer, the cop that was doing the arrest. It was just really fun, mostly just watching my brother interact with the people that he worked with. He loved the people he worked with, and they loved him.
Bob loved his job a lot. It was his whole life.
My brother was very, very successful. He had a good home that they lived in, they had nice cars, and he did make good money.
everything that we could tell about Bob Samuels from all of his friends, from his family members. He was a warm, loving, hardworking man.
There was no indication of anybody coming forward that really had a hatred of Bob Samuels.
But according to Mary Ellen, good old Bob may have been hiding secrets. She identifies a few enemies Bob made in the movie industry.
Mary Ellen had mentioned that Bob was taking some extra film that he would sell for money for his own personal use. And she believed that maybe someone that was involved with that, or the fact that he had some difficulties with people at Subway, the franchise that they own.
But it's hard to take anything Mary Ellen says too seriously. Her husband's murder seems to have sent her off the deep end.
The way she spoke to detectives, at one time crying, and then you turn around and she appears to be laughing. It appeared like she was flirting with one of our homicide detectives. At one point, she rubbed the top of his head with her hand. He was bald and said, "I like bald men."
Mary Ellen Samuels was a very attractive woman. She was dressed somewhat provocatively with a low-cut top, and police noted that frequently she would lean over so that her cleavage would show, and that seemed to be part of her persona.
Investigators check out Mary Ellen's leads, but none pan out. Just days after Bob's murder, the case is treading water.
Nothing really came up as a viable suspect in the case.
It's fair to say that this was a mystery. It appeared to be somebody who knew Bob, and yet Bob had no enemies.
This true crime tale had classic Hollywood elements, a puzzling murder, a glamorous setting, and a suspicious dame. To stay on the killer's trail, cops were going to need a lucky break and another body bag.
The murder of Hollywood assistant cameraman Bob Samuels has all of L.A. stunned.
I was at work and I came home and my mom was in the den. And she said, "Honey, I got some terrible news for you." And I said, "What?" And she said, "Well, Bob Samuels is dead." And I'm like, "What?" And she said, "Bob's dead."
Investigators have no suspects, but soon have reason to hone in on the supposedly grieving spouse.
Information began to come in about Mary Ellen and what she had received as a result of the death of Bob Samuels.
The sale of the Subway shop and the insurance policy that she had on Robert provided her with a lot of money.
Had Bob lived and they'd gone through the divorce, she would have received about $30,000. As a result of his murder, altogether she received about $500,000. They were being asked to pay off on a homicide, and so as a matter of routine practice, they contacted the investigative agency to say, "We're about to release the money. Is there anything that we should know about? Is there any reason why we shouldn't?" And there was insufficient evidence to say she is a suspect.
Detectives have to ask, was Mary Ellen's windfall sheer coincidence or something more sinister? They take a closer look at the couple's history. Bob grew up in a small town near Disneyland, not far from his future wife.
Mary Ellen Samuels was a very popular, pretty young girl. Bob had a crush on Mary Ellen from the time that she was 8 years old.
Mary Ellen and her family lived right behind us. A lot of the time was spent with the neighborhood kids and, you know, playing street football and playing football down on the church lawn.
Mary Ellen was always very outgoing, and she always had boyfriends. The guys always liked her. When she walked in her room, I mean, you knew Mary Ellen was there just because she was very pretty. The way she held herself when she walked, she was very confident.
Mary Ellen and Bob went their separate ways. She eventually married someone else, had Nicole, and divorced. Meanwhile, Bob remained a bachelor and pursued his career in the movie business. Years later, they met again at a high school reunion.
She said, "Remember that boy that lived down the street? That real cute guy?" She says, "Well, that's who I'm dating now."
I know Bob was in love with her, and they fell really kind of head over heels over each other.
As time went on, folks started wondering if she was more in love with Bob's showbiz status than she was with Bob himself.
Mary Ellen, she was into the flash, and she was into the glitter, and she was into being a show-off.
Mary Ellen was caught up in, I think, the glamour of my brother working in motion picture. He tried to make Mary Ellen a part of that as much as he could. I mean, whenever they'd finish a movie or they'd have a wrap party, you know, he would always want to take her there.
But she didn't always draw the right kind of attention.
Mary Ellen was a very flamboyant, vivacious, attractive woman who liked to dress accordingly.
The way that she dressed, it was always really short, or really low cut. Bob resented it. He asked her not to wear something or that he didn't approve. Mary Ellen was over the top.
But if Mary Ellen was all spandex and lace, Bob was more the flannel and blue jeans type. He could have sucked up to LA's movers and shakers, but he preferred a quiet life in the valley.
Bob was a total simple man. He was never extravagant. He looked wonderful when he dressed, but it was never outrageous or inappropriate.
But Mary Ellen wasn't content playing the happy homemaker.
When Bob was away, she ended up spending a lot of time in nightclubs. She was taking her daughter to a lot of the places that she was going to, and she wasn't even of age yet.
When she was 16, 17, 18 years old, Nicole Samuels and her friends would go out bar hopping with Mary Ellen Samuels. She would help them get dressed up. Also, somewhat provocatively, Mary Ellen Samuels hired a male stripper for her daughter's 16th birthday party.
But all this partying requires some loot. Soon, Bob's paychecks disappear into thin air.
He would be sending money home to Mary Ellen, and he said, "Frank," he says, "I don't understand where all the money went to. I sent her, you know, my paycheck for the month." And he says, "I got home and it's all gone." I think that was at a time when she started drifting and maybe got involved, you know, with drugs.
He was out on location one time and he called me and he said, "Jerry, she spent $20,000 in 1 month." And I said, "Well, what'd she buy?" He said, "Nothing. There was nothing, no car, no furniture, nothing new."
This was definitely not turning out to be a match made in heaven. Bob was willing to work through his problems with Mary Ellen. But after 6 years, her appetite for the wildlife had outgrown the marriage. One day, Bob came home and found the house empty.
He was pretty distraught and upset, and Mary Ellen had taken everything and left him a letter.
The letter said things like, "Our marriage has gone stale, and I don't like to have to explain to you every time, you know, I want to write a check, I want to buy something."
Mary Ellen moves into a nearby condo with Nicole. Hoping to woo her back, Bob lets Mary Ellen run the subway and kicks in $1,200 a month.
Bob really wanted to take care of her even during this period of time. Financially, he wanted to make sure that her and Nicole were going to be okay. I think he finally ended up realizing that this was not going to work out. He ended up filing for divorce too.
Separated or not, most widows tend to lay low after a husband's murder. Mary Ellen went shopping.
Oh, she threw money around like it was growing on trees. No compunction whatsoever about his homicide. She just very open and having a good time.
She immediately began to travel. She went to Las Vegas within about 2 weeks and bought herself a fur coat. She went shopping at a place that she loved to have custom clothes made. It was a place called Trashy Lingerie. We came across a number of credit card charges for $1,200, $800.
She ended up spending it wildly. She was having parties for her and her daughter and spending. She wasn't the grieving widow.
She bought a 928 Porsche. She was spending a lot of money and enjoying herself. all on the proceeds from the death of Bob Samuels.
I don't think she thought that she was spending lavishly. That was just Mary Ellen.
As if her spending spree isn't tacky enough, she packs her bags, leaves her apartment, and takes possession of Bob's house.
She and Nicole moved back in as soon as the house was released by the LAPD. They didn't hesitate at all.
Within months of Bob's death, Mary Ellen and her new boyfriend head to Cancun to buy a condo. What better place to stage a scene out of indecent proposal, using $20,000 of your dead husband's insurance money?
They had this cash on them. They went into their hotel room, got something to drink, locked the doors, just enjoyed themselves. And I thought, you know, that would be kind of cool to do. If I had a lot of money, I would do it.
Actually, it was rather disgusting. I couldn't believe it.
When you have someone who is thoroughly enjoying themselves on the death of somebody, and they're reaping their rewards of that death, it appeared very, very odd, very, very suspicious.
I think we really knew at that time that she was the one, you know, that had Bob murdered. And it was really hard knowing that she was scot-free, you know, spending money and taking vacations and driving new cars.
You've got to be pretty stupid to arrange a hit, then drive around town rubbing people's noses in it. Then again, without a shred of hard evidence, the Merry Widow was virtually untouchable. But police were determined to see her sweat.
I'll be perfectly honest with you. We believe that you had something to do with his death.
Oh, my God.
Months after the murder of L.A. assistant cameraman Bob Samuels, cops take a closer look at his estranged wife, now literally rolling in her dead husband's dough. The LAPD may be long on suspicion, but they're short on evidence, until an informant reaches out.
An anonymous phone call came in to Devonshire Station indicating that Mary Ellen Samuels was actually looking for someone to kill her husband.
The mail caller claims Mary Ellen had been going around town asking people to bump off her husband.
Mary Ellen Samuels basically said to him, "Have I got a deal for you? I will come up with the money if you kill Bob Samuels."
Seems the caller wasn't the only one Mary Ellen asked for help.
Mary Ellen was doing a lot of drinking in bars and partying, and she was actually contacting people and asking people if they knew anyone to commit the homicide, you know, looking for a hitman.
She was just coming out right, talking to people, advertising, looking for somebody to murder my brother. Didn't seem like she was even trying to hide it.
Mary Ellen Samuels would go from bar to bar and club to club and restaurant to restaurant, and everyone she met, she would ask them if they would help her kill her husband.
And as detectives find out, anyone willing to listen to Mary Ellen's pitch got a laundry list of reasons why Bob had to die. Not only did she claim that he abused and cheated on her, she said that he had molested Nicole when she was a child.
I think she was trying to win these people over, trying to get them to be on her side, and it was all lies. She just told all lies.
The investigator at the time researched all of the records, all of the crime reports having been filed by either one of them, and there was nothing. Nobody had ever reported any type of abuse.
Nor did anyone report the fact that Mary Ellen was cruising around town looking for a hitman.
None of her drinking friends or the people that she was around really thought she was serious about it. You know, they just thought it was the fact that she was just ranting in the bar, you know, about what Robert had done.
It's very bizarre to realize how many people were solicited and nobody thought to go to the police. Nobody thought to warn Bob Samuels.
According to the tipster, Mary Ellen did manage to convince one man to take the job, James Bernstein. a small-time crook and petty drug dealer who'd been bottom-feeding off the Samuels' payroll and dating Mary Ellen's daughter.
James Bernstein, it turns out, was an individual that helped out at the Subway sandwich shop.
Considering his employment history, it's hard to believe that anyone in their right mind would give Bernstein a job.
He came into a store that I managed quite a bit, hung out a lot. So much so, he started helping customers and so on. I ended up hiring him. We had some cash that came up missing, about $5,000. Started interviewing people. James kind of broke down during the interviews and said he took the money. Paid back what he hadn't spent. We let him go. We didn't press any charges.
He bit the hand that fed him, and then he groveled for mercy. It was hard to believe that this moron actually considered himself a player.
Thought himself as kind of a wise guy. You know, he's from New Jersey, had the New Jersey accent. Kind of reminded you of Goodfellas a little bit. I don't know how he made rent. You know, to me, he didn't really seem like he was always working any job at any length of time.
James Bernstein was basically a drug dealer. He was into the cocaine trade. He loved to brag about being the cocaine dealer to the stars.
James Bernstein was the type of person that wanted things done easily. He was looking for the easy buck.
Bernstein met Nicole at a party. They quickly became an item. But like her mother, Nicole had expensive tastes.
He was pretty hooked on her. He fell pretty hard for any type of woman that would have him. James would buy her some pretty expensive jewelry, dresses, clothes. Every penny that he could get, he would put it into buying her something. I told him that he was being used.
Rao tells investigators that Bernstein confessed to being connected with Bob Samuels' murder. But at the time, Rao thought he was making it all up. He never believed that Bernstein could carry off such a violent crime.
One thing he told me was that they did the job and he was going to get a portion of the insurance money whenever Mary Ellen got paid. Told me all his plans of what he was going to use the money for, buy a new car, so on, go off with Nicole. James told a lot of stories. Just thought it was another one of the stories.
Given Bernstein's history of crumbling under pressure, investigators are eager to start grilling him, along with his alleged co-conspirator, Mary Ellen Samuels.
We have taped statements from people that said that you were out looking for somebody to hit Bob.
Oh, my
and
God.
Well, I'm just telling you, we've got tape statements from people who are close to you, and we've got corroboration tonight from that, and...
Well, I'd like to know who these people are.
There were a number of witnesses that came forward to say that they saw Mary Ellen Samuels hand $1,500, $2,000 over to hitmen.
I don't know who is doing this. I have no idea who is doing this, but this is the most asinine thing I've ever heard in my life. I could not hurt a fly.
For hours, Mary Ellen continues to deny.
Well, let me ask you, are you going to dispute the fact that that these people are saying that you went out shopping, so to speak, for somebody to...
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And what about...
We had our fights, but my God, I would never have anybody killed for him. I wouldn't even know how to go about doing it.
Mary Ellen was a very clever individual. She wouldn't make any statements. She wouldn't say anything that was going to cause her problems.
But Mary Ellen has an alleged accomplice, and he's not nearly as cunning. Now, cops tend to keep suspects far apart, but in this case, they had a different strategy. Throw them in the same pot and watch it boil.
I know you didn't do nothing. My God, Bobby, you're... I know, for God's sake, I did. What the hell is going on here?
He says that he knows 100% that you and I did this
thing. Oh, yeah, right.
Investigators believe that Mary Ellen Samuels hired James Bernstein to kill her husband, Bob. They throw the suspects into an interrogation room and hope that the pressure will cause at least one of them to crack.
They are put in there together and left there for a period of time in the hopes of hearing some conversation that at that point is not privileged information, but can be used against them.
I know you didn't do nothing. My God. Bob and you were friends. I know, for God's sake, I did. What the hell is going on here?
He knows that you, he says that he knows 100% that you and I did this thing.
Oh, yeah, right.
James Bernstein was very nervous about being interviewed or being involved in this case or his name being put forward.
In talking with Mary Ellen, she would never make any statements to James or allow him to say anything that would incriminate either of them.
He's saying that you're going to inherit $500,000.
Oh, yeah.
This.
Yeah, right. He knows exactly how much money
and
I
told
him.
He wants to know what my cut is. He knows that I'm in love with Nicole.
Oh, since when? Because you had a crush on her at one point in time?
Neither of them would make any admissions at all. They talked about being questioned, but they would never make any statements that would incriminate him.
He told me he's got tapes.
Yeah, he told me he's got
three people.
Yeah, I think he said
that implicated both of us.
Wow.
And I said, I don't know who that could implicate me in anything.
Well, I'd like to know who. Mm. Who would be that mean to do something like this? I cannot believe this. This is a nightmare.
It's got me plenty scared.
Well, you feel me shaking.
The detective makes a last-ditch attempt at scaring the suspects into a confession.
Mary Ellen, you're not being honest with us, Mary Ellen. You're just, you're skirting issues. You're trying to make up
issues.
A story.
I'm scared to death.
Well, you may be scared to death, too, but you know, your husband's dead. He ain't scared to death no more. He's dead. He's out of the picture, and you're rich.
No, I'm not rich. I'm far from rich. Well, I'm telling you, right here and right now, I'm going to look right in your eyes when I tell you this, okay, that never, never at any point in time did I talk to anyone about shooting my husband or killing him or hurting him in any way, shape, or form.
Or looking for someone to get him killed.
Or looking for anyone for him to get killed.
The only thing they had was the circumstantial evidence of her trying to find a hitman, and without physical evidence, or at least something to corroborate your suspicions. There's no way they could have charged her.
After hours of interrogation, police have nothing. They are forced to let the suspects go, and the case flounders once more.
It was another small piece to the puzzle, but it wasn't the smoking gun that the police were looking for.
It's frustrating at times to know that you're on the right track, but you can't get people to confess.
In the days after the interrogation, Mary Ellen shows no signs of being rattled. Bernstein, on the other hand, shaken in his boots. And it turned out he had plenty of reason to be worried.
Last phone call I got from James, he seemed a little nervous. You know, he said, hey, you know, I'm just gonna go to the cops, tell them what I know. I've had it, I'm tired. Situation. He just wanted to rid himself of it. He stated, if I got to do some time, so be it. Then it couldn't be that bad.
A few weeks later, the Ventura County Sheriff's Department gets a call. A body has been discovered in the mountains north of LA.
There was a couple that were driving along Lockwood Valley Road and stopped to look at some scenery. And when they exited their car, there was an odor in the air that drew their attention, and the gentleman investigated to find out what it was and where it was coming from, and discovered a human body down off the road. Very decomposed. The insects had gotten into the body, and they were still very active, and it was a very gruesome scene.
The autopsy determines that the victim was strangled to death. and the body has been roasting in the hot sun for so long, the flesh has turned to leather.
In order to identify him, the coroner was forced to use a process to rehydrate the hand so that then the fingerprints would become obvious.
You inject saline into the finger to inflate the skin back to its normal state.
Police run the fingerprints through the database and ID the body as none other than James Bernstein.
I got a knock on my door. It was a couple of Ventura County sheriff's investigators and showed me a picture. Wanted me to know if I knew him. I was pretty shocked. I had, you know, no idea that he would end up in that type of situation where somebody would want to kill him.
It was a bombshell when information came in that James Bernstein was found dead in Ventura County. To have that potential suspect show up as dead, all kinds of fireworks are going off.
Don't cross Mary Ellen Samuels. Either you end up shot in the head or face down in a ditch. Of course, that was all supposition. Mary Ellen's still one step ahead of the cops, and she intends to stay that way.
Police are now convinced that Mary Ellen Samuels was behind the murders of her husband, Bob, and her alleged hitman, James Bernstein. Their investigation leads them to Mary Ellen's friend, Ann Hambly. It was in her home that Bernstein was last seen.
Ann Hambly was a friend of Mary Ellen. Ann was in it for a couple of reasons, mainly for the money, but also the fact that she was Mary Ellen's friend. Mary Ellen had asked Ann to allow Jim to stay at her house because he was afraid to go home because either drug people were looking for him or the police were going to get him.
Hambly tells police that Bernstein did move into her house, but he stormed out in a huff 2 weeks later.
She and he got into an argument, and she told him to leave. So he just picked up and left. However, he left some very personal stuff at the house, and she said he never came back. She was very nervous, and it was very evident that she wasn't telling us everything that she knew.
Sensing that Hambly is close to crumbling, investigators turn up the heat. They tell her they know Mary Ellen is a murderer. If Hambly refuses to cooperate, she could be charged as an accessory.
We needed to convince her that we had more information than she was providing. We knew that she was more involved.
Investigators decide to bluff. They confront Hambly with the only evidence they have, her and Mary Ellen's phone records.
We showed her she was actually in contact with Mary Ellen on the night that we were sure that James disappeared.
As the pressure mounts, Hambly begins to realize that her loyalty to Mary Ellen isn't worth a stint at the California Institute for Women. The police work pays off, and Hambly spills her guts.
Once Ann Hambly began to talk, she laid out the entire pattern beginning in 1986, continuing on with the divorce, with the financial situation, with all of the attempts to hire a hitman, with the fact that James Bernstein finally agreed to do it.
A few hours before the murder, Bernstein headed out to supposedly rip off some drug dealers with Hambly's boyfriend, Paul Gall, and another man, Daryl Edwards. Then, according to Hambly, once they got far enough into the mountains, the two men suddenly veered off the road and began attacking Bernstein.
They took turns. One would hold his legs while the other one beat him, and then they'd switch when they got tired. As you can imagine, James Bernstein was fighting for his life.
At one point during the fight, he looked at Paul and said, "I really screwed up, didn't I?" And according to Paul, this is why he said yes.
The two men ultimately strangle Bernstein to death and throw his body over an embankment. A sad end to a sad life.
You know, I think that James Bernstein just wanted to belong to the group so much and wanted people to like him.
James was actually kind of a pathetic individual. His life was very mediocre. He was easily used, and Nicole used him for whatever she wanted. And Mary Ellen found him easy to manipulate and do whatever she wanted.
It looks as though at the end, Mary Ellen Samuels discarded him by having him killed.
Bernstein's secrets died with him that night. To this day, his exact role in Bob Samuels' murder remains a mystery.
We really never knew exactly how involved James was. We never knew if he was the actual hitman or if there was another person there that was involved in the homicide with him. And the only people that could tell us that was Mary Ellen and James, who was no longer available to talk.
Perusing financial records, cops easily uncover the hard evidence that links Mary Ellen, Hambly, and the hitmen. Checks amounting to $5,000.
There were at least two checks that were made out to Ann Hambly. Each one of them was for $1,500. And these were checks that Ann Hambly would cash to pay off the hitman on James Bernstein's murder.
It's not very much, but you gotta remember these were all people involved in narcotics. And it's amazing what some people will do for a small amount of money.
Officers take Bernstein's killers into custody and both confess. A little more than a year after Bob Samuels' murder, the party is over for Mary Ellen.
She had a new boyfriend. She bought a condo in Cancun. So she was out there having a wonderful life until the time that the police finally were able to put together enough evidence to arrest her.
We have been waiting for a long time for this to happen. I don't think Mary Ellen had a clue of all the evidence that was being turned over by her girlfriend.
I think that she felt that she was, again, going to get away with what she had done. This is, you know, the second or third time that she had been taken to the police department, and each time she's walked away from it.
Flashing her body, her cash, and her seductive rap might have worked in the bars, but it didn't play in the courtroom. This broad was finally going down.
The much-anticipated murder trial of Mary Ellen Samuels kicks off, and all of L.A. is watching.
The trial of Mary Ellen Samuels became a media event because here you have an attractive woman who reportedly had her husband killed and then had someone else killed, all for money.
The prosecution wastes no time exposing Mary Ellen as a greedy, heartless woman. She is even nicknamed the Green Widow.
It was really in reference to that infamous photograph of Mary Ellen in Cancun with nothing but the $20,000 covering her, and the fact that the murder had been orchestrated for the sake of the almighty dollar.
The prosecution presents documents proving that she would inherit $500,000 after Bob's death. And they call countless witnesses to testify that Mary Ellen had gone all over town soliciting someone to kill her husband.
Mary Ellen's drinking buddies were more or less ready to admit that, yes, I heard her talk about having Bob killed. Yes, I was there when she tried to hire a hitman.
Just the planning. She was so devious. I was just shocked about the amount of people that she had involved.
Having turned state's witnesses, Ann Hambly and the hitmen describe exactly how Mary Ellen set up the killing of James Bernstein.
It was determined that Ann Hambly would call Mary Ellen Samuels and say that she'd spoken to her sister. And that was the message to Mary Ellen Samuels that Bernstein was dead.
Now it's the defense's turn. Mary Ellen's attorney claimed that she had nothing to do with either murder. They argue that James Bernstein killed Bob to defend Nicole.
She believed that she was framed. She believes that Bernstein killed Bob because of Bob molesting Nicole. And they were so angry, and so he just wanted to help.
What was interwoven throughout their defense were all of these character assassinations of Bob Samuels and the suggestion that he had abused and molested Nicole and Mary Ellen Samuels. In my opinion, they were never able to substantiate any of that because none of that ever happened.
Everything she told was a lie, and I knew him from 1971 to 1988. He was never a child abuser or a wife beater.
As for James Bernstein's murder, the defense claims that Gall and Edwards had most likely beaten him to death in an argument over drugs. Just when it seems the case can't get any stranger, Mary Ellen takes the stand.
She did not represent herself as the grieving widow. She was being very cutesy up there, kidding around a couple times. When the statement about her rubbing the head of one of our ball detectives at the original crime scene, she made another little comment about her, one of her attorneys that was bald. A person who is innocent doesn't act this way when they're on trial for a capital murder or the death penalty.
Mary Ellen Samuels did testify that her lifestyle really didn't change after the murder of Bob Samuels. And of course, that was easy to refute with event after event and receipt after receipt.
In the end, that cheesecake photograph of Mary Ellen all draped in Benjamins makes the single biggest impression on the jurors.
The old saying about the photograph is worth 1,000 words, in this case, it is worth more than that.
One of the jurors stated that that was one of the most compelling pieces of evidence in the case. It showed her for what she really was, a very greedy individual.
After 18 days of deliberation, the jury finds Mary Ellen guilty of the murders of Bob Samuels and James Bernstein. She was later sentenced to death and became the fifth woman on California's death row.
One of the greatest injustices of this case is that Mary Ellen Samuels got away with killing Bob Samuels twice because she took his life. But she also took the only thing that probably survives after death, and that's his character, his reputation. She had so slandered him during trial, unjustifiably, that he didn't even have a death with dignity.
I was very sad because she had taken somebody's life and somebody who was so very important to us away. Because we all loved him so much and so many people loved him.
I really try to stay focused on the times that I shared with my brother, and he was a great guy, he was my best friend. There's not a day that goes by that I don't think about him. I miss him a lot. I miss him really a lot.
Samuels has already contested her death sentence without success and still has numerous appeals remaining. She blew it when she shopped the bargain aisle for a hitman. Funny, with her fancy clothes and jet-set lifestyle, you'd think she'd understand the you get what you pay for thing.